Today, I'll be answering Google's 10 most searched questions about Adobe Illustrator. Number 1. How to remove background. Right off the bat, I'm noticing that a lot of these questions come from people who are probably used to working with Photoshop and are transitioning to Illustrator, which is to be expected, since Photoshop is far more popular than Illustrator. So, they're basically trying to do in Illustrator what they do in Photoshop. With this in mind, I believe this question refers to removing the background of an image. Illustrator is not really the appropriate software for background removal, but here's how to do it anyways. What you need to do is create a clipping mask on top of the image. Select the pen tool and draw a path on top of the thing you want to separate from the background. Remember to close the path once you're finished. After the path is drawn, select both the path and the image and press Ctrl-7 to make a clipping mask. You can also do this by going to the Object menu, then Clipping Mask, and then Make, or by selecting Make Clipping Mask in the right-click menu. Clipping masks in Illustrator work similar to regular masks in Photoshop, where you're not effectively cropping the image, you're just hiding parts of it. You can still move the image inside the mask, and you can release the clipping mask anytime by going to the same menus I've just shown you, or by pressing Ctrl-Alt-7. Now, if you do in fact have experience with Photoshop, please, do this there. It's far easier and yields far better results. Illustrator and Photoshop are not alternatives to each other, they are different softwares for different uses. And in fact, this is something that I've already explained here on the channel, so I'll leave the link to that video up here in the corner if you want to check it out. Number 2. How to change background color. There is no such thing as a background color in Adobe Illustrator. The white artboard that you see when you create a new document is not really white, it's in fact transparent, and we can confirm that by turning on the transparency grid in the View menu. Think of the artboard not as a white canvas that you'll draw on top, but as a bounding box that Illustrator uses when exporting, so anything that is placed outside of the artboard gets cropped off. The way you actually change the background color in Illustrator is by literally creating a rectangle that covers the entire artboard. You can just press M to select the rectangle tool and click and drag to draw. Then, using the color panel, you can change the rectangle to whatever color you desire. And if you don't want to be bothered by accidentally selecting this rectangle while you work on other objects, you can open the Layers panel and lock the object there. You can also do that by selecting the object on the artboard and using the shortcut Ctrl-2. This will prevent this object from being selected. And well, I said that the artboard is not white, but that's also not all true. The artboard is transparent, that is accurate, but whenever you're exporting to a format that doesn't support transparency, like JPEG, Illustrator will fill the transparent areas with white. So in a way, the artboard is white, but not always. Number 3. How to use. Well, that is a very broad question. You open the software, create a new document in the size you want, and start adding objects to the artboard. Most of the time, you'll be adding geometric shapes, text, and images. Some of the most important tools are the selection tool, the pen tool, the rectangle tool, and the type tool. You can move around the artboard by holding the space bar and then clicking and dragging, and you can zoom by holding the Alt key and then using the scroll wheel on your mouse. Panels are also a big part of Illustrator, and you use them for a lot of different things. You can use the color panel to change fill and stroke colors, the Align panel to align objects on the artboard, the Pathfinder to combine shapes, the Gradient panel to create and edit gradients, and the list goes on and on. Teaching you Illustrator is not something I can do on this video, but I've made this playlist here with a few videos that might help you get started. This one explains the basics in 10 minutes, this one explains all the tools, this one all the panels, this one is a list of my favorite shortcuts, and this one is a deep dive into the pen tool. Number 4. How to cut out a shape. This one is quite easy, and there are a few different options to choose from depending on what you want to do. First, we can use the Pathfinder panel. Select both the shape you want to cut out and the shape you want to cut out from, and use the Exclude function. This will use the object that's on top to carve a hole on the object that's on the bottom. You can do the same thing with the Shape Builder tool. Select both shapes again and then press Shift-M to select the Shape Builder. You can see that the shapes now get highlighted as you hover on top of them. Hold the Alt key to change the tool to the Exclude function and click once on top of the shape you want to cut out. The end result is the same as using the Pathfinder. Both these options only work with vector objects. You can't cut out a shape from an image in Illustrator. The only option is to make a clipping mask, which we have covered already. A bonus tip. If you want to make a clipping mask out of more than one object, like using an image as the fill color of a text, you'll find that it's not possible to just select both the objects and the image and make the clipping mask as usual. That's because each character of the text is a separate object, and we need to tell Illustrator to treat them as a single object. We can do this by turning them into a compound path. Just select all the objects, go to the Object menu, then Compound Path, then click on Make. Now, just select the objects and the image and create the clipping mask as you normally would. Number 5. How to fill color. In Illustrator, fill is how we call the color which is contained inside a path. The color that is filling the path. The other option is a stroke, which is the outline that runs on top of the path itself. If by how to fill color you mean how to paint the background, then check number 2. Otherwise, we have a few options. First, you can change the fill color of an object through the color panel. Just select the fill color there and adjust the color to your liking. You can also change the color through the properties panel or select pre-saved color swatches on the swatches panel. A fourth option is to use the fill color picker below the toolbar. Just double-click it and choose a color. Lastly, you can also change the fill color of an object through the appearance panel. And here, things get more interesting. You can actually add multiple fills to the same object by clicking on the Add New Fill button. Bear in mind that these fills observe a stacking order, so the one on top of the stack inside the panel will be displayed on top as well on the artboard.
But Andy,
I hear you asking,
why would I want more than one fill?
And well, the magic lies in the fact that each fill on the appearance panel can be customized with different effects that will only affect that fill and not the entire object. So, for example, you could have two fills with different colors and apply an offset path effect to the fill that's on top and reduce its size by a few pixels. Then you could add a drop shadow to create the illusion that one fill is floating on top of the other, and perhaps a convert to shape effect to turn the square into a circle. That really looks like two objects now. And the cool thing is that this workflow works for strokes as well, so you can create some pretty complex and responsive designs with just a single object. In fact, I've explored how powerful this panel can be in this new Morphism tutorial, so check that out, it's a pretty cool effect and super easy to create. Number 6. How to make background transparent. For this one, you either want to make the artboard transparent, and we've already seen that the artboard is transparent by default on number 2, or remove the background of an image, which we've talked about in number 1. There is, though, one more thing I can add to this matter. To make sure you're exporting an image with transparency, there are two things you need to do. First, once you have your artwork ready, open the Export for Screens window by going to the File menu, then Export, then Export for Screens, or by pressing Ctrl-Alt-E. Here, you need to select a file format that supports transparency. Those are PNG for image files and SVG or PDF for vector files. That's number 1. If you wish to export a PNG, which I'm imagining you do, there is step 2. Click on the gear icon to open the advanced export settings, select PNG, and make sure that transparent is selected on the background color drop-down menu. Okay, now you're good to go. Number 7. How to change canvas size. Changing the canvas size in Illustrator is extremely easy, but what you're referring to as the canvas is actually called artboard. Canvas is the place where the artboards are placed. If you zoom out, you can see the entire canvas, this big gray square. And this one has a fixed size, you can't change it. But also, you probably don't need to. In my 10 years of using Illustrator, I don't think I ever ran out of space in the canvas. Now, to change the artboard size, just select the artboard tool on the toolbar, or press Shift-O. With this tool, you can move, resize, and create new artboards. To move, just select the artboard, click and drag. To create a new one, click and drag on an empty space of the canvas. To resize it, click and drag on any of the edges of the artboard. However, all these actions can also be performed through the control bar, which is my preferred method because it offers much greater precision. You have input fields for the X and Y position of the artboard on the canvas, which you can use to move it, as well as width and height values, which you can use to resize it. To add a new artboard, you have the New Artboard button, which will create a new artboard that's the same size as the last one created, so you don't need to bother about changing its size later. In the control bar, you can also change the orientation of the artboard to landscape or portrait, rename the artboard, rearrange them when you have multiple artboards, or open the selected artboards option. I don't think I ever used this last one though. Some of these actions can also be performed through the Artboards panel, but I mostly use this panel when I need to change the order of the artboards, since all the other options are much easier to do by using the Artboard tool and the control bar. Number 8. How to curve text. There are two ways to curve text in Illustrator. One is using a path and then using the Type on a Path tool, and the other is using an envelope distortion. Let's check out each one. First, there is the Type on a Path tool. Different than the normal type tool, where you can just click anywhere and start typing, this one requires you to already have some sort of path on the artboard. This path can be any shape, and overall, it's a pretty easy tool to use. You click anywhere on the path, and it'll start typing on that spot. Three handles will appear along the path, and you can use them to move or flip the text along the path. The thing about the Type on a Path tool is that it only curves and distorts the actual baseline of the text. It doesn't distort the characters themselves. To do that, we need to use the Envelope Distort, which is located in the Object menu. There are actually three different types of envelope distortion: Warp, Mesh, and Top Objects, but they all work more or less in the same way. They create a vector mesh with anchors, paths, and handles that you can move around and edit in order to distort the object that's inside. They just have different approaches and different customizability levels for the same goal. Distorting with Warp is probably the easiest of them all. You have a list of distortion presets in this drop-down menu, and each one will distort the object in a different way. Arc, Flag, and Rise are some of my favorites. To control the amount of distortion, you can use the Bend slider, and it goes both to positive and negative values, which just inverts the direction of the distortion. You can also choose to apply the distortion along the horizontal or vertical axis of the object. Under the Distortion section, you can also distort the object horizontally or vertically, which will add perspective to the distortion. Distorting with Mesh is more of a manual labor. You define how many lines and columns you want the mesh to have, and then you manually have to move the anchor points and handles of the mesh to distort the object inside. I don't particularly use this one much, it's kinda hard to be honest, so I think you're better off with the other options. Finally, distorting with Top Object does precisely that. It uses any shape you place on top of the object you want to distort to create the actual distortion. This one is super cool and fun to play with, and you can create some very interesting shapes with it. It's also really useful to create perspective. Number 9. How to crop. Okay, those who are googling this have one of two ideas on their mind. Either they want to change the artboard size, which we have already covered on number 7, or they want to crop an image, which is what we'll see right now. In fact, that's a very straightforward process. Select the image, click on Crop Image on the control bar, and set up the crop the way you want. You can set a specific value and resolution on the control bar. Once you're done, click Apply and you're good to go. Bear in mind that once you crop the image, you'll lose the link, so the image will now be embedded. And it's also a non-reversible process. If further down the line you want to go back to the original image, you'll have to re-import it to Illustrator. Number 10. How to merge layers. Well, merging layers is not something that is possible in Illustrator, at least not in the same way that it is in Photoshop. In fact, layers altogether work differently in Illustrator than they do in Photoshop. In Photoshop, every object that you create or add is a new layer. It's a very layer-focused workflow. Effects and masks are applied on the layers themselves, and there are even adjustment layers that will affect every layer below them. While in Illustrator, layers work more like a group of objects that help you organize your file, and they can contain multiple objects inside them. You can, and most of the time will, work with a single layer in Illustrator, at least based on my experience. You'll usually have multiple layers in very complex designs with lots of objects, or in some specific scenarios. Back to the point, merging layers is not possible in Illustrator, but neither would that be useful in any way. The closest thing we have to merging layers is grouping, and for that, you can simply select all the objects you want to group, and group them by pressing Ctrl-G or using the right-click menu. Illustrator will treat groups as a single object, so selecting one object will select the whole group. Scaling, moving, and rotating will also affect the group as a whole, and effects are applied to the whole group instead of every object individually. Grouping also has the added benefit of working in isolation mode, which you can access by double-clicking the group. In isolation mode, you can select and transform individual objects that are part of the group, but everything else becomes temporarily unselectable, making it easier to edit the contents of the group without the need to ungroup it. To leave isolation mode, you can just double-click anywhere in the artboard or press Escape. To ungroup the objects, just hit Ctrl-Shift-G or use the right-click menu. Hey, Andy from Editing here. As I was recording some footage for this video, I realized that you actually can merge layers in Illustrator, which shows that I haven't used layers all that much in Illustrator, so I'm sorry about that. But the fact is, the way you can merge layers in Illustrator is really different than the way layers are merged in Photoshop, which is what I believe people were looking for when they searched for merging layers in Illustrator. Essentially, what merging layers in Illustrator does is it places all the objects that were in multiple layers into a single layer, and then it deletes the empty layers. And the way you can do that is just selecting multiple layers in the Layers panel, then going to the Options in the top right corner and choose Merge Selected. So yeah, there is that. I don't think this is all that useful. I don't think this is what people were looking for. But anyways, here's how to merge layers in Illustrator. If you enjoyed this video, check this other one here. A special thanks to all my Patreon supporters who help me make high quality content like this one. More on how you can support the channel in the description down below. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and leave a comment if you have any doubts. Thank you so much for watching, and have a great day. Bye!